Hello, Chris Standing. Hey, man. So when's your event? You're having something inside. Spring break. It's called Spring Break. How many bands? Well, you know, when I sent you the email, well, basically, I can bring my camera down and I got 5 cameras, right? So I can HD. Yeah, and so basically, I could come down there and do some shooting, and we can, you know, get your event on film. So it's like, what you do, I mean, you can promote the hell out of it, right? Of course, right? So there's going to be people there. Yeah. Well, you know, if there's, yeah, I hear you. Well, you know what, man? Seriously, just if you, okay, you making a movie is kicking it up a notch. Like, big time, man. Like, if you... like, I don't know what else is going on out there, but like, if you guys are like promoters and you guys are, there's only so much you can do, right? And no one's doing this. No one's making a movie. If you make a movie, you know what? Yeah. Yeah, 5 cameras, HD. All right, send me an email. Let me know. Yeah, man. It's all going to be good. All right. Okay, man. I'll talk to you soon. Looks like I'm going to Saskatoon.
Okay, these are just some of the collection that I've been keeping as a mom of their shows. So this is just a folded up poster of the current show that's going to be coming up.
When I first met the Standings and the Independent Dog Face, I think it was the very first fashion show that I did, which was 3 or 4 years ago.
And as you can see, there's different styles.
Well, I think since we're like different age groups and demographics, we cover different areas. Like my dad, he has more like influence in the hockey and stuff like that, and some of the like the cover music and everything. But I kind of try to go more towards like a film or something, or different kind of genres of music and stuff. Right?
Some of these posters were created here, and some were created by the former Pat Hotel and some of their staff, and they had a nice deal going with them.
Oh yeah, we worked with the Pat nightclub. They've shut down. They gave us our first chance. I think a lot of our events really brought in, like, kept them going and kept their bills up and stuff, because we had a lot of people coming into that venue.
And then here's kind of like the poster cards, that handbills that Chris would hand out all over the place. There's Nosedive Business Cards. There's Chris at his old address. This was during a conference.
My name is Matt Mitchell. I've been in the bar business here now for only about just over 2 years. Before owning part of Rock Bottom here, I worked at Joe's and the Pat, which is a big staple here in Saskatoon. Sad to see it gone.
This is this year. Here's a signed one from George last year. That's a prized possession.
I love working with them because they're funny guys and really organized, really professional, which is very nice.
And then here's New Year's Eve, and I'll see if I can find one with the fashion show stuff.
I don't know if it was their first or second year they were doing it. They had it at the Pat, and I was lucky enough to be working there that night and saw the huge success that it was.
These are some of the cards that Chris hands out.
As soon as the Pat went down and I was able to get into this business venture, the opportunity came up to have them here at Rock Bottom for their spring cabaret, and remembering everything that happened at the Pat and what a great night it was, and everyone was happy.
Theater companies all do similar type stuff. They'll have a big poster plus these for handout as part of their marketing and all that kind of stuff.
We had really an obligation kind of to try to get it here at my bar.
Technology, so when they people put their phone on there, it'll link them up to something that's linked to Independent Dog Face.
Like my family members, they go to school here and all that, and that's what they say. They see everywhere the Independent Dog Face, like flyers, posters, and stuff like that. And so it's everywhere. That's the good thing about working with you guys, is you know how to promote extremely well.
Well, right now we've done about 27 shows, so then it's all kinds. A lot of them have been sort of like, they've been acoustic acts, they've been rock acts, they've been country acts, they've been all sorts of bands.
Hip-hop.
We've given some young bands some chances. We've had teenagers up on the stage. We've had models.
My name is Helen Aro. I'm a fashion designer. I work for Native Max magazine. I'm the beauty/fashion director, the Canadian regional director.
During a big conference or native hockey tournament or event, we try and time it with that. But we also had some standalone shows that did okay. And but that's kind of the goal too, is we wanted to have to be a draw on our own. And I think we are. We're starting to get a good following, and we can have something just by itself, and people will show up for it. They'll come and get hotels, and they'll spend a weekend with us. And
get out our native talent in Canada here. Us natives are talented people, and we need to showcase that. And the independent dog face seems like they're doing their job well. Like they're showcasing our native talent and.
Look in the camera and say independent dog
face. Independent dog face. Come on, show tomorrow.
My name is Lemmy Kozan. I've been here both 3 years. We were prior owners of the Fez on Broadway. That was about, like I said, 3 years ago. We brought in some new partners just last year, and we just switched it over to Rock Bottom, and we've decided to go in a little bit of a different direction. And yeah, it's basically a family-owned and operated business around here. And
we used to play this nightclub called The Pat, but it got knocked down, I think it was 6 months ago. And we used to play there at least once a month, and at very minimum, maybe once every month and a half. So past 3 years, I'd say about probably 30 gigs now, 30 to 50 comfortably.
That's the amount of shows you've done with...
Just with them, yeah. Yeah, independent dog face, yeah.
So I collect these. Sometimes I don't get to grab their stuff because they're in a rush, and sometimes they think I'm a pest asking for these, but...
Oh, I totally believe working with promoters and stuff like that helps a ton, because it takes a little bit of legwork from my end out.
It's up to each band. Like, I guess each band is their own entity, their own business, and they got to really hustle out there. They got to market themselves.
You know, I can still help out with, you know, postering tickets and whatever else we can really jump on board with, but for them to put their product out there helps a lot more for them to do the legwork themselves, just like I would like other bands to do that themselves.
And they got to bring a few people into the gate.
You know, we'll do our end, but we'd appreciate it if a lot of people did their end like these guys do. So it helps out a ton.
You know, I think they're valuable. They're a good piece when they're going to try someplace new.
So it's easier for us if we know some bands coming in from some local reserve, and they bring in 15, 20 people. Like, that helps us out. It's easier to throw them in a lineup.
Well, you have your good bands and your bad bands. For the most part, I've only ever really seen good bands. There's only been a few bands that I've been argumentative about stuff that kind of...
Last night, for instance, we had a band here that, just because they couldn't play when in second or third, they decided to just up and leave.
You just want to say Motley Crue-esque, maybe, where their riders and stuff like that were kind of excessive, looking at this thing like, you guys want this, and well, what? That's...
You know, that's... That's a little bit of a problem, and you know, I don't think we've ever had any issues with these guys around here like that. It's being professional.
Well, these guys really haven't organized good. There's always some events we've been at, like, where like different people. They're sometimes you don't even get paid like what they're gonna pay. But these guys are always, their organization is pretty clean, and it's always, we've never been ripped off by them or anything, and we never get rooms though. Hey.
So what was life like before independent dog face and stuff?
Oh, it was better. It's fucking girls and there's pussy. Now sausage, it's always like, take last night for example, it was fucking sausage fest. Gotta get us some freaking rooms. Freaking, we're always trying to have to go find a place to crash at on a floor somewhere or something.
That's why we slept last night.
Really?
I haven't slept yet.
Hey. He's wandering the streets all night, our bass player. He's sleepy. There's Curtis says to us before we walk into his house, oh, I hope my dad does. Hope my dad's hearing aid's not on. Like, fucking, there's like two girls there.
It was that's my favorite thing about it. It really made me feel a part of not just my native community, but to be able to establish a scene in a market for other venues such as Rock Bottom, The Pat.
Okay, serious now. Before that, before our gigs, before Independent Dog Face, it was like, Well, they weren't promoted good, and they're usually just like, you know, like a hockey dance or something.
I think there, it was always available, but nobody was doing it professionally. And I think Independent Dog Face was a great middle, like the middleman for these bands to get into these venues they think they can't get into.
Or like, a wedding. But now working with these guys, everything is like an event, like a planned out, well planned out event, like a concert style kind of event, which is a major, which all revolves around promotion, which these guys are really good at. Extremely good at. They still throw Sausage Fest though.
You know what I see right now? You have this scene. It goes from Northern Ontario down through Northern Manitoba, Saskatchewan, up into Alberta and all through the territories.
When we had the AFOA National Conference, or Aboriginal Financial Officers Association National Conference here in 2011, I can't remember, one of those 2 years anyway, we were able to kind of hook up Independent Dog Face and put together a show.
And as much as I don't like, as a musician, as say the Aboriginal music scene, there's something going on there where we're playing nonstop every weekend. We got at least one really good paying gig.
No other city had really done something like that before, to put a like a live music venue on for the delegates while they were here. And
it reminds me a lot of Motown, where we just did it for ourselves and we weren't getting hired, we weren't getting into the major centers, but then we realized, you know what, we're busy, we're playing all the time, and that should be the only reward, is in the action itself of playing the gigs. So
here, and these were people from right across the country. Like the AFOA conference is second basically only to the AFN conference in terms of the number of people that come to that conference. So putting that on, and the feedback that we got the next day from everybody was, this was great.
Right now, with what Independent Dog Face is doing, I think it's going to play out that you'll see the scene expanding further down south. Well, we're starting to break into Saskatoon right now, so that's exciting. But I think the old Seaweeds Cabaret that used to be in Saskatoon here, and that was the only place that in my lifetime anyways, they would bring quality Aboriginal acts into this area. And since that place closed down around 2001, 2002, there really hasn't been anything until Independent Dog Face started putting on their cabarets.
My name is Corey Dallas Standing. What do I do?
Hi, I'm Aaron Okamason. I play bass guitar for Nosedive, and I also sing.
Give me one thing at a time.
Yeah, sorry. Just one thing.
Yeah, give me three things, and I'm what?
Well, when I first started playing metal music, as like, you know, young, angry teenager, so.
We started off as a thrash metal band. Our band name is Nosedive.
Not everyone really likes metal music, but you know, I liked it, but I'm not an angry teenager anymore. So
we had a hard time in our scene for a long time, just because there's not enough venues. Metal music isn't an in thing, and there's not much money involved with that.
So yeah, Nosedive, we've been working with them. Well, obviously that's my brother's and that's his kids.
I don't know, the cabaret music, it's fun.
So there's rarely any shows or time to get any practice. And Independent Dog Face was a great way to work with my dad and my brother to get shows.
They've grown more to like play with like rock and some covers too, but they also made some indie rock music. Nosedive, I enjoy their music too. They got some original songs, and they're like any band too. They got their ups and downs. They still got a little bit thrash in them, and a little in their rock now, and a little bit of party too, so they're growing with us, and they helped us out a lot.
The more stage time you get, the better your product gets, and the better your the more your sound gets out there.
Yeah, I love them, man. They're my brothers, and Corey, Everett, and Aaron, and yeah, and it's awesome. Yeah.
Thank you.
because my sons are strong-willed and they all have a different artistic expression, all three of them, their foundation for that title, I believe, came from their sister, Crystal.
Independent Dog Face was my sister Crystal's. She would make this is like when people would make burn CDs. She'd make burn CDs for the family. Then she had her own little dog face logo, and she had it all printed off on her CDs. She'd have like one of those CD printers.
Oh, my sister came up with it. It was like an inside joke. We're just joke. She likes dogs and stuff, and then just
Independent Dog Face. It sort of it's what we're about too. Like the independent, we're all supporting independent artists.
Where she print the label and everything, and she had her own logo and said Independent Dog Face, and we just laughed because it's just something in our family where just it's a humor that we all started laughing right away.
She had a I don't know, printing, copying, digital recording type thing she was doing privately on her own, and I think they just kind of borrowed it from her and she gave it to them formally.
It became like an inside joke, Independent Dog Face, and then she just started working on little projects, side projects, like just editing like a little pictures and in music and stuff, and it was just a funny thing. And
Independent was really strong, a word that we liked, and we enjoyed that name.
And then we needed a name for once our show started becoming more regular. It was like, well, we need a name to a production name, because I had other friends who were promoters and they had a production name, so we need a name. And
Dog Face was something like really unique name, because we're thinking like, who else has that name?
Yeah.
And so like it sort of caught on us. It's like anything, you always try to fight and you try to find something, but then you want to make it sort of fun.
We were too lazy to think of a name, so then we gave her a little bit of money. He's like, here's some money, blah blah blah, then
it sticks.
I want to make something that sticks. So it became Independent Dog Face, three words, and we stuck with that. We tried so many other names, but
it's like now we're Independent Dog Face, and we took the logo and made posters, banners, and threw it on everything, and made stickers, and now people around the community, they all recognize that logo. But it all started with just a family inside joke.
I like the name itself. I'd like to see the little dog on a necklace or something.
Yeah, Black Rain, they've been really awesome for us. They've been like a really good draw, and what I like about them too is that they're really good to their fans. They spend time with their fans and they really connect with the people in the community and stuff. And
my name's Jamie Pikikut from Sandy Lake Reserve, aka Attack-A-Coop.
And that's what needs to happen for like a lot of these bands. Like you can't just play and then go home. You need to sit there and visit with people who are enjoy your music.
I'm Ryan Pikikut from Black Rain. I play guitar and I sing. And we're from Sandy Lake, Saskatchewan.
And that's what they do, and that's awesome. And they got a lot of views on YouTube. And
I'm Kevin Joseph. I've been with Black Rain for about, I think, 5 years now.
They got original music, and plus they play like a good party music, cabaret, and
me and this guy Ryan, my brother, who was a guitarist, we started basically as kids. Our family is a very musical family. Our dad played in a band with his uncle, with his brothers.
So it works in both areas. They can do like a all original, or they can rock out at a wedding or a party or hockey dance or something. And
we've been playing forever, all our lives, me and Jamie together.
It's awesome, and we're always happy to have them. Like my dad said, we can, if they're in town, we'll do what we can to go and support them, say hello, and go and tease them a bit too.
Me and Ryan, and then before that, our grandpa was a fiddle player. Before that, our great grandpa played fiddle as well. So it's always been with us.
I've worked with Seaweed. I traveled with them for about 6 years.
I don't know if he told you the story, but I got a guitar and he got a set of drums when I was 7 years old, and I was eight and he was five on Christmas. And ever since then, we've been playing pretty much every day.
And any given night we can play, maybe a couple hundred people show up, and it doesn't really matter where, so.
Black Rain, they play probably a stronger rock music, which is good. There's three people in the band. Got to know them over the years. They've also been a good draw for us. They've also brought a crowd for us too, and then they're good at marketing themselves, marketing their name.
We barely ever came out here. They were the first ones that started hiring us lots out here. Curtis is a good guy.
If there's Black Rain and they're playing someplace, I'll go out of my way just to, if the time's right, I'll go out of my way just to make sure I drop in and listen to the boys, and it's all good.
Curtis, he used to, my dad had a band, and I don't know if Curtis stayed with us for all. I know he was very close to my big brother, and he was always over, and they used to go and jam on my dad's band's equipment, even though none of them knew how to play, and make the most terrible sounds, and break some strings, and break some drum heads, and all that, but that goes back to when I was like 2 years old, 3 years old. That's how far I go back with Curtis. So he's pretty much family, you know, I've grown up with him, grown up knowing him.
And what was it, 07, we were partying at in our reserve at our a friend of ours, her name's Sharon Haneke. Res girls, me and Jamie were at a party and we were just sitting around, and it was a real bright full moon night, and it was just a beautiful night, and me and Ryan were sitting there with acoustics at the table, and Jamie started doing that whoa, and I can't remember if it was me that was playing or Ryan was playing, but I immediately just started chilling out at Sharon's, just having a beer, and I don't know, just came from there. It's a true story, right down to every word on there. We were booked to record our second CD like a week after that. Jamie was texting my cousin Lenny, and he was in the Canwood. It's just exactly how it goes. And we're, I don't know what it is with us, we work really good under pressure, and we only had like half of the CD written, all written and finished. And we had that song written. We just sat there at the table with those girls we were sitting with, and we just wrote the words down on a paper there, and that was it. We had it written. 2 days before that, we jammed one last time, and we wrote Res Girls, and Marlena's song, and a couple other songs. For some reason, we just were lazy like that. Jammed it out the next time we played, and it's been probably our biggest hit, that one. Mexico, I've had that lyric and the intro, that guitar part there, since you ever see that movie From Dusk Till Dawn, that George Clooney and the vampires and all that?
Yeah.
In Mexico, we were, Ryan's been playing that on acoustic like past like a year.
Well, the singer for Just the Boys asked me to write them a song, so I pulled that one out and I started jamming away and wrote it.
And I don't think he really heard how good it was, like the way me and Kevin heard it.
And then next weekend we were playing with him in PA, and I showed it to him on the stage. Hey, I finished that song, and I wrote you guys a song, and showed it. Hey.
And he was actually trying to give it to Dean, and with Just the Boys. He's trying to sell it to them, for them to record.
Jamie comes walking around the corner there, and he heard it. Hey, what the fuck's that? He goes, hey.
When I found out about that, I said, no. So I put a stop to it. That's why.
I just wrote that. I wrote that for these guys. Fuck that. He goes in.
But anyways, he was trying to give it to Just the Boys, our good friends, and I didn't let him. I'm glad I didn't.
And he's still pissed off, Dean, the singer. He's still pissed off at us for not giving it to him. I wrote him another one though. It's called I Got a Small Wiener. We were trying to write songs for our $100 hickeys. Oh, no, no. Well, for the Under the Gun CD there.
She doesn't like it when I'm drinking. We wrote that. We were jamming at my house, me, Ryan, and our old bass player.
We were just playing there, and I was sitting by the phone, eh, while we're... After every song we'd play, eh, the phone would be ringing, and I'd pick it up.
That was, remember, back in the old days, prehistoric days, when people had phones in their house?
And she'd answer and she'd say, well, when are you coming home? Are you going to be home right away?
She kept phoning him, come home now, and he's like, No, we're jamming. I said, and after a while, she kept like every song. After every song on the phone, we were like, come home now, she'd be saying. No, fuck, I kept saying. Finally, I hung up the phone and Jamie got, what the fuck, what does she keep phoning for, Jamie said.
Finally, he just hung it up and she doesn't like it when I'm drinking. That's how it came to be. And
had that whole song written in about as long as it takes to hear that song. Basically wrote it right on the spot there. It was really quick. Jamie is just writing away on his snare drum.
He writes the lyrics on the snare drum?
Yeah, most of the time. And he flips it over when he runs out of room.
She doesn't like it when I'm drinking.